My name is Rene Williams. I'm assistant professor at the Molecular Photonics Group at the University of Amsterdam. And today we will discuss the Shockley-Queisser Limit. You will hear about the view of a physical organic chemist, that's me, on the complex mathematical framework that describes the limits of solar cells. We will also discuss how to surpass these limits. You can wonder, how efficient can a solar cell be? Organic solar cells and perovskite solar cells, they are third generation materials, thin film solar cell materials. They have a nanostructure that is important for their properties. So we can wonder, you have already seen that this is the definition or how you calculate the power conversion efficiency. Power out divided by power in. Power in is related to the solar spectrum. It's 1,000 watt per square meter or 100 milliwatt per square centimeter. Power out is correlated to the open circuit voltage, the short circuit current, and the fill factor. And the fill factor is like an ideality factor. The open circuit voltage, it's just when you connect the two contacts of a solar cell to a voltmeter, and it's the voltage which you can measure. And if you short circuit them through an amp meter, then you can measure the maximum current, but there's no voltage then. And this is all for a single unit, so one solar cell unit. 1,000 watts per square meter, that's the solar spectrum. It's the standard AM1.5 solar spectrum. So what about this fill factor? The fill factor is depicted here. Here we see the measured current voltage curve. Here we see the open circuit voltage. Here we see the short circuit current. So if you make a square between these values, then you have a surface. This here, the blue curve, is the maximum power point. So it's like the product of the voltage and the current. And it has a maximum about here. So if you take this square, that gives the area is related to the maximum power. So the ratio of these squares, the blue square and the gray square, that's the fill factor. So if you're current voltage plot is going like this. If it is totally horizontal here and then totally vertical there, then you have a fill factor of 1. Fill factor, it is important, but the voltage that you can attain, and especially the current that you can attain, these are the really, really important aspects that are very, very difficult to control, especially the current. Now, what determines the open circuit voltage and what determines the short circuit current? The open circuit voltage is basically a material property. And they're related to the band gap. We can also talk about the homo-lumo gap, the lumo of the acceptor, the homo of the donor for instance, organic photovoltaic. So it's a little bit like the energy gap that you need to have the excitation, the band gap. If you have a band gap and your photon is much higher in energy, then you have thermal relaxation to the first state from which the chemistry occurs or from which the charge injection occurs. The excess energy of the photon is released as heat. The current is the number of photons that can be converted into electrons. Just one photon, one electron, that's what you want. The open circuit voltage is basically linearly correlated to the band gap of the material, and the band gap we express it in electron volts. But you see, there's always a loss due to thermalization. Voltage is basically a material property. The voltage is usually not influenced a lot by how you exactly make the device out of the material, but the current is. The current can be expressed in various ways. So we have what we call an external quantum efficiency. So that relates to all the photons that are hitting the system. We also have the internal quantum efficiency. Then you only discuss the photons that are absorbed. So it's basically the number of photons that's hitting your material and the charges that are extracted or collected. Ideally, we want every photon that hits our material to be converted into an electron. But if the photon does not have enough energy, then it can never generate an electron. Mr. Shockley and Mr. Queisser, they made a paper back in 1961 about how this can be best described by theory. Now, you can have a look at this paper. It is very, very complex, very mathematical, but it is the Shockley-Queisser limit. It's used a lot. It's very important in solar cell research. And I just try to tell you what I understand of it. I am not going into the mathematics at all. And it is important to notice that Shockley actually also invented the transistor. So modern day computer technology, we owe it to Mr. Shockley. So he's a clever guy. Here we see something about the efficiency. We focus on one junction. If you make multiple junctions, you can increase the efficiency. So if you go to infinite number of junctions, you can maybe get to 60%. But we talk about one junction, and then it is about 34%. This represents efficiency, and this is the light that is absorbed in an ideal way. It is going up to about 900 nanometer. The light that is absorbed, this part of the solar spectrum is what is absorbed, and the maximum efficiency that can be attained is then about 34%. If you calculate it exactly, then it is 925 nanometer or 1.34 electron volt. That is the ideal band gap, because then you have the maximum voltage and the maximum current. In blue, we have the Shockley-Queisser limit. So you see here the theoretical IV curve. You have about 1 volt. You have about 35 milliamps per square centimeter, a fill factor of almost 90%, and that leads to a power conversion efficiency of 33.6%. So this is the maximum you can attain with a single junction device. The other percentage here is for the ultimate. It's a different model, but it's not practical. So we have seen that the open circuit voltage, it decays if you lower the band gap. For the short circuit current, it goes the other way around. The lower your band gap is, the more photons you can absorb because of the shape of the solar spectrum. So these two lines, they have a different slope. And of course, the product is what is important. So this is the limit, this black line here. Now that's the maximum efficiency that you can attain. These here are the band gaps for the material. So silicon has a band gap of about 1.1 electron volts. Here, this is the maximum efficiency that you can attain with silicon. Here we have it for gallium arsenide, which is also a very popular solar cell material, but then for space applications. So in that way, you can understand that it is the voltage as well as the current that you have to optimize, and it's the product that gives a certain maximum. If you look at this curve, you see that the optimum is somewhere between 1.1 and 1.4. So this here are the nanometers. So you want to have a material that absorbs, let's say, between these wavelengths, then you can be in this optimum. So if you have a very, very close look, then 1.34, 925 nanometer, that is the maximum. Because of the shape of the solar spectrum, there's this dip here. It is basically related to the light of the sun, which also has a dip there. But it does mean that you have to try to be in this area if you want to get to really high efficiencies. This is a picture from the people from AMO, from Pullman, and you see that the band gap and the Shockley-Queisser efficiency is here plotted. These materials are less than 50% of the limit, so that is dye-sensitized solar cells or a non-crystalline amorphous silicon. At the top here, we have the materials that are within the 75% of the limit of Shockley and Queisser. Here we see gallium arsenide. It is very, very close to the limit. Crystalline silicon, but also perovskite, is close to this limit of the Shockley and Queisser. This is actually the same type of figure from their science paper, but it also now contains information on the carrier management and the light management. Cadmium telluride, it is close to the limit of the current, but the voltage is not very optimal. So it loses out on the voltage. Gallium indium phosphide, now that gives an excellent voltage, but the current, it can still be improved. So in that way, it needs better light management. It needs to be better at converting photons into electrons to optimize the current. The carrier management optimizes the voltage. So the conduction, for instance. The Shockley-Queisser limit, it has a few assumptions. First of all, what is not absorbed cannot be used. It's logical. The spectrum of the sun is like the radiation of a black body radiation. Now also a solar cell, it heats up, and because it's a hot black object, it emits or it loses radiation according to Planck's curve. So that's not a lot, but it is intrinsic in the model. There's also what we call impedance matchings. It means that there's optimal flow of electricity, which can be related to resistance. So that's within their model, that's optimal. Furthermore, and this is more going into maybe something that's related to spectroscopy and chemistry, the Shockley-Queisser limit, it assumes only radiative charge recombination. So that's actually what came back in the perovskite story. If you create charges in the material, they just wander around until they find each other, and then they can recombine by emitting a photon. If this is the only loss channel, then you only have radiative charge recombination. Non-radiative charge recombination, it means that they go into areas where they get lost because of defects. So that is very important. The Shockley-Queisser limit, it assumes the absence of non-radiative charge recombination. So charges are only recombining by emission of light. This is unavoidable. The Shockley-Queisser limit, the band gap that determines the voltage, the amount of photons from the sun that can be harvested, they are important for the current. You have power out divided by power in. So if you look at these kind of IV plots, or if you look at data, it's very simple. If you have 1 volt, then 33 milliamps gives you the Shockley-Queisser limit. Every photon above the band gap, if it is absorbed, then it makes electron hole pair. So this efficiency is assumed to be 1. And it's also the collection efficiency is 1. So there's some loss due to this black body radiation and thermalization. So important is that there's no non-radiative charge recombination. We can say at open circuit conditions, it means that charges that are recombining to give light, actually in the production of silicon solar cells, people also look at the electroluminescence of a solar cell. And if there are cracks, then these areas are more dark. Using radiative charge recombination of a solar cell can tell you about defects in the material, especially if there are large defects, cracks in that they have a fault in the production process. This is what people actually do. So this implies, very strangely, a good solar cell is also a good light emitting diode. So if you inject charges into a solar cell, there is light at the band gap area. As we said also for the perovskites, a high photoluminescence quantum yield and a long photoluminescence lifetime, that's a very good properties because it fits with the Shockley-Queisser limit, with their theory that you only have radiative charge recombination. These are the basics of the Shockley-Queisser limit, and there are a few assumptions that can be addressed. So one of them is that there's only one electron hole pair formed with every incoming photon. One photon gives one electron hole pair. That is intrinsic to the Shockley-Queisser limit, to their theory. But maybe we can change that. Another is that there's thermal relaxation. So the excess energy relative to the band gap is lost. If you have a band gap here and your photon excites here, then this energy going to this level is lost. It's thermalization that is intrinsic to the Shockley-Queisser limit, but maybe we can work around it. Okay, the third one is the light. It is related to unconcentrated sunlight. Of course, you can also concentrate your sunlight, but that's we will not talk about that. So how can we do that? How can we go beyond the Shockley-Queisser limit? One thing that we can do, that we can try, is to create 2 electrons from 1 photon. Now that's what we call singlet fission. So you can split a high energy singlet state into 2 triplets. You can convert these 2 triplets into electrons. You have 1 photon, 2 electrons. Your hot area in the solar cell research, it's quite complex. You can convert 1 singlet into 2 triplets. The next step, however, is quite difficult. Another thing that you can do is to try to use this high energy to avoid the thermalization. And that's what we call hot charge injection. At the Physics Institute, the IOP, people have also been working on hot charge injection. So prevent the thermalization. This is what I wanted to tell you. Back in 1963, Shockley and Queisser, they described the limits of solar cells. These limits still are extremely important in the field. The maximum voltage and current we can get is basically defined by the energy distribution of the photons from the sun. Radiative charge recombination is inevitable. We can go over the Shockley-Queisser limit by using singlet fission and hot charge injection.